An Oral History of the Church. I'm Adam Christman.
And I'm Jonathan McCormick.
An Oral History of the Church is a conversational history podcast. This first volume is an oral history of the campus relocation of Golden Gate Baptist Theological Seminary's main campus from Mill Valley, California to Ontario, California.
The second episode for this volume is an interview with Master of Divinity student Daniel Choi.
So, Jonathan, you experience Daniel more often than I do with your job here at the seminary. Where is Daniel from?
Daniel is an international student from Australia of Korean descent. And he is not of a Baptist background. He's comes from a Presbyterian background.
Right, so those are all completely different than Dr. Orge from our first episode. And frankly, from a lot of the other folks we've already interviewed.
Yeah, we've interviewed a couple faculty members. We've interviewed a local pastor. Daniel is someone who's going to experience the day-to-day process of the relocation. And as an international student, there are things about where a campus is at that relates to his ability to get a visa. So he's going to experience a lot related to the relocation.
Yeah, exactly. So he'll have a different perspective being from a different country, being from a different ethnicity, and from being a student rather than being in a position of power at the seminary or being an ally of the seminary like that pastor and his wife are. So I think that's very significant. He'll be a very helpful addition to this oral history. We like to give tips for unique elements in the interview coming up. And uniquely about this episode, I'm going to give a tip to Jonathan because he actually did not get to be in the room with Daniel and I when we were talking. So, Jonathan and listeners, I would listen for Daniel's reasoning why he came. Why he chose Golden Gate Seminary. I think that's very significant, very interesting. And I think that was probably, for me, the most invigorating and interesting part of the interview.
Well, on that note, let's take a few minutes and listen to our interview with Daniel Choi.
Okay, so today is March 11th, 2016. This is Adam Christman, unfortunately without Jonathan McCormick. He had a previously scheduled thing he needed to get to. This interview is taking place in the large conference room of the Golden Gate Seminary Library. It is downstairs. This is at 201 Seminary Drive, Mill Valley, California. And I'm sitting down with Daniel Choi. So, Daniel, I'm going to go through these series of questions. You answer them as you're interested and willing. So first, how did you first hear about Golden Gate Baptist Theological Seminary?
I was exposed to the Southern Baptist Convention, the SBC.
Mm-hmm.
To be honest, it was more like as I was looking for a seminary, my father wanted me to look for a Baptist university, a Baptist seminary, that is. And in that process, you know, we had the big names out there. I mean, you know, we've got the one in Dallas, the one in Fort Worth, and all that stuff. But as I was, you know, praying and just like looking through different options, I just started to look at the list and I found one in San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
And so I thought, that looks pretty interesting. Did a little bit of research, you know, next to the ocean.
Mm-hmm.
not up somewhere in a random mountain somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Off
to a draw for new students.
I didn't want to go into one of those. I'm not gonna say it. So at the end of the day, it was down to me being interested in the Southern Baptist Convention.
Mm-hmm. So are you not raised in a Southern Baptist church?
No, I was more my father's a Presbyterian pastor.
Mm-hmm.
But his church was predominantly independent while we were in Sydney.
Mm-hmm.
So at the end of the day, it was just like... I was pretty open to go to whatever seminary.
Mm-hmm.
My dad wasn't too particular about, like, you know, one's better than the other. The only important thing was which seminary will teach you the Bible the best. Mm-hmm. And so that's how I got to know Golden Gate.
Mm-hmm.
So, like I was saying, I was researching, and I'm sure that we're going to build up onto that, but I saw that the seminary was moving.
Mm-hmm.
And the opportunity to live in two different cities was a great incentive.
Mm. So how is that an incentive? Because for maybe a pessimist, that might be a difficulty, might be a hardship. So, but you see that as an incentive. Why would you say so?
Well, if you're from Sydney and you look at all the, you know, like American movies, mm-hmm. and American shows, everyone always talks about San Francisco. Everyone always talks about LA.
Mm-hmm.
Here's a school. I can live on the school, like in the campus, twice, or 2 years in San Francisco, 2 years in LA. So I thought, I thought that was pretty good.
Yeah.
Because I'm here to learn anyway. I'm here to learn about American, like, culture and all that stuff. That's all fine. But, you know, to be honest, like, you know, it's not that much different anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But to actually live in two different cities, two mega cities, I thought that was an incentive in itself. Yeah,
that's really exciting. So our follow-up question, you've already largely answered. The question is, how did you first come to study or work here? Do you have anything else you want to add to what you've already said about that?
Yeah, so I've mentioned Bible, you know,
mm-hmm.
speaking at the Bible, that's fine.
Were there any particular teachers that drew your eye?
No.
Not especially? No. It was mostly the convictions of the school in general?
Yeah, it was the Bible-based teaching, mm-hmm. The Bible study programs, and just the general understanding that the SBC is a very word-driven, you know, just... What's the word I'm looking for?
Denomination.
Denomination, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I'm joking or being serious, but, you know, the location was pretty cool.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's not a bad thing for sure.
Yeah. And but yeah, no, seriously, out of all the variables, I just didn't want to live in the mountain, just caught up, trapped, I guess. That's how I felt when when I looked at the other ones, and I thought,
mm-hmm.
you know, those cities out in the desert, like, I'm not calling Texas a desert, but as far as I understand,
they do have some desert.
Yeah, as far as I understand, from not living in America, I just thought, if there's no ocean around me, that's really hard.
Mm.
And, but again, that wasn't like a major, major variable, but it was like I said, it's like when I saw that I could live in San Francisco,
mm-hmm.
and when I saw that I could live in LA,
mm-hmm.
That really got my attention, because my goal in America is to learn as much as I can before I leave.
Yeah.
And if I'm confined to one specific place, that's what kind of withheld me from going to the other schools, was that mm-hmm. I felt that I was going to be confined and just really focus on one or two like areas.
Yeah.
Whereas if I come, like, whereas at a school like San Francisco,
mm-hmm.
you know, the Bay Area is just very open, and again, the move down just, it forces me to learn and adapt as much as I can.
Mm-hmm.
And learn two different... I'm going to use the word cultures, because, you know, a lot of people will argue that, you know, Bay Area culture is different from, you know, SoCal. So
that's true. I went to 2 years of school in Riverside, which is in the LA area, and it's significantly different in its culture, how it is up here. And, I think you will find that to be true, and that's really smart that you notice that if you get more connection points, more variety, that you will learn more. That is true. We do the same in just even a classroom setting. The more times you do something, or the different ways you do something,
yeah.
the more likely it is to stick.
Yeah.
So that's, I think that's a wise choice, or at least a wise reason to come to Golden Gate.
Yeah. I mean, academic stuff, you could literally learn it online.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You don't really need to...
Right, and we have that even here.
Yeah, it's... Mm-hmm. But then the opportunity to live somewhere,
mm-hmm.
two different places, and at the same time have the same... So it's like you're learning the same academic stuff,
mm-hmm.
but you're learning two completely different cultures.
Yeah.
Environments. So mm-hmm. That is the incentive.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I've actually talked about this before as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there was like a school gateway magazine thing. And
oh, okay.
Yeah, that was like this. Yeah, I'm making the same point as I did back then.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so I hope that's...
Yeah? Yeah. So how long have you studied here so far?
This is my fourth semester.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm in my MDiv program.
Mm-hmm.
And this is my fourth semester. You know, learning about... I categorized it. I put my learning... I categorized my learning process. I did the Old Testament first with
mm-hmm.
the Hebrew,
mm-hmm.
and now I'm doing the New Testament with the Greek.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my understanding, to have that, I guess, foundation of knowing the Bible in the original language.
Sure.
And building up the rest of the education on top of that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good. So what are the classes you have this semester, and who are your professors?
This semester in particular, I'm taking two of Dr. Wiata's classes.
Mm-hmm.
His Greek and his elective, it's called First and Second Corinthians.
Mm-hmm.
That's been... I think I'm going to use the word academic breakthrough.
Because
I finally figured out a weakness that I had.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's... I think and I write in big ideas,
mm-hmm.
but I don't know how to make that into 500 words.
Oh, yeah.
my notes are 1,500 words.
Yeah. So you're learning how to bring it down to... Yeah.
And I'm doing that weekly, and at first it was very difficult, and I think I'm getting better.
Yeah.
But we'll see. previously... Dr. Urbino,
mm-hmm.
I took him for Old Testament and with Hebrew as well.
Mm.
And that was a trip. Yeah.
Yeah, I had him as well for Old Testament. Not Hebrew. I took that with Dr. Gouch. And, but yeah, those were good classes.
Yeah.
Did you work hard?
Yeah, that broke my mind. Yeah,
were you able to piece it back together?
Oh yeah, thankfully. Thankfully.
Yeah.
Yeah. His class was a paradigm shift for me. I opened up to a new perspective, completely new perspective of looking at the Bible.
Mm.
And yeah, so two very different lessons, I guess. From I've had other great professors here.
Sure.
And I could say very similar things for a lot of them, but Dr. Durst and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But in particular, I think Dr. Urbino helped me re-examine how I viewed the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
And Dr. Wiata is really helping me. It's like an espresso. You know what I mean?
I'm actually not a coffee drinker, so I'm not really sure what you mean.
Now,
that might be anathema to our listeners, but...
Yeah.
I'm sorry, listener.
Yeah.
Hi, Mom.
But it's just so compressed.
I see.
It's like all that information, you compress it, and when you run the water through it, you get that really like thick, just...
Okay. It's distilled down, like it's potent.
Yeah, it's very potent.
More potent, yeah. All right.
That's what I'm learning how to do.
Yeah, one of my best papers that I wrote in the seminar portion of my PhD program was the shortest paper I wrote. By requirement, he said this many word for your paper, and those of us in the class afterwards were like, are you kidding? Only this many? That's not very much. And then we wrote the papers, and I had to cut, like, I stopped at a certain point and said, I'm already 8 pages over. So then I took those pages and trimmed everything down so it fit inside his word limit. And it's the best paper I may have ever written in my whole life.
It's when you compress that idea and sharpen it. So, yeah, I guess the analogy that I gave him was, I told him that I felt like I was swinging a blunt blade.
Mm-hmm.
A nice blade, but it was very blunt.
Mm-hmm.
But through his 500-word kind of weekly commentary analysis,
mm-hmm.
it just feels like it's being sharpened.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I'm appreciating it. And again, I'm only talking about those two professors because, you know, I don't want to go too far.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So our next question is, what is your current role at Golden Gate Baptist Theological Seminary? You said you were in the MDiv program. Do you have a concentration declared or...
I wanted... Oh, see, okay, here's some of the negatives. Fine. Yeah, oh, yeah, this is good. I wanted to do a concentration in spiritual formation.
Mm-hmm.
But because of the move and because of, like, the recent, you know, like, they're changing the syllabus a little bit, mm-hmm. I guess. Like, you know, I think they're changing... They're getting rid of a couple of the spiritual formation classes.
Oh, okay.
I don't know exactly what's happening, but I heard that, you know, it's not going to be the same... And spiritual formation classes might just... They might... I mean, some of them aren't even open anymore.
Mm.
Which is why I was very... I was a little bit... I guess I missed out a little bit.
Mm.
But I don't want to go too far with that. As long as I still get the information as much as I can.
Yeah.
I'm still pretty happy with it. So if there's a negative, that was, I guess, not being able to concentrate on anything. I'll probably just keep concentrating with the Bible study stuff.
Yeah.
You know, biblical studies and
mm-hmm.
exegetical and hermeneutical stuff. Yeah.
Well, you already covered some great stories already of your experiences here, but our next question is, what are some of your favorite memories of studying at GGBTS in this location? And you've already mentioned your thinking was... significantly changed and helped by Dr. Urbino, and your thinking and expressions of those thoughts are being refined by Dr. Wiarda. What other favorite memory or memories do you have of your time here?
I think that if John was here, you know, Jonathan was here, I would definitely would have said something about, you know, to him directly, is that I have come to learn and, you know, really utilize the commentaries, the resources that we have at the school. Coming to a library was a very arduous thing for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll bring my own books. And a library was just a place where I studied with my books.
Yeah.
But ever since coming to Golden Gate, I've learned how to study with not my books, but with resources.
Yeah.
You know exactly what I'm talking about. Yes, it's definitely. Not just like, oh, this textbook says this and I memorize the textbook. That's university level.
Mm-hmm.
That's undergrad level.
Right.
But ever since coming here... and thanks to John, he really helped me because I had very specific questions and he helped me very thoroughly, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's like that. It's his style. But that had to be a great experience for me. One of the highlights of learning how to navigate myself through all the resources.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, I'm not going to say I understand all of it yet and I'm not maximizing it. But yeah.
Yeah.
But right now, I have taken that next step to learn how to gather as much as I can.
Yeah.
Again, which is why I'm tying this back to Dr. Riyadh, is that I've learned how to gather all of it. And it was, and you know, just knowing that that's all out there, it's what do you do with it now?
Yeah.
I think another one I have to mention is, it has to be the preaching course that I took with Dr. Roj.
Mm.
you know, at the end of the day, we're all doing this to... The reason why I'm studying the Bible is to tell people what the Bible says.
Mm-hmm.
And what Dr. Orge mentioned in his class was that he wanted us to have excellence every week, week in, week out. We're not preparing a sermon for like once in like what, every full moon, right?
Right.
Because that'll give us time to prepare and really like, you know, try to put more into it. But no, we're doing this to do a weekly Bible study, weekly preaching, weekly routine of just having that high excellent, like, you know, that level of excellence.
Right.
And you know, it's not about, you know, we can say it's not about the excellence, but delivery is a key component, and
mm-hmm.
you know, Paul talks about it as well in Corinthians and stuff like that. So.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, yeah. So that's what I'm learning, is that I'm learning how to deliver, really apply it back to life,
mm-hmm.
and just what's another academic thing that I really liked? It's out there somewhere right now.
Or it doesn't even have to be academic. If you have another favorite memory from being here,
yeah.
You know, like some people we interview, they got married at this location, or they met somebody who got them into the job that they've now been in for 20 years.
Mm.
So it could be anything.
Mm. Okay. Well, at this point, I've had a blast just learning new stuff.
Mm.
And I don't think anything tops that yet.
Mm.
It was semester after semester after semester of just thinking, you know, just about that time when after the holidays you come back thinking, oh, okay, so it's, you know, what more can I learn?
Yeah.
And you realize, oh.
A lot more. Yeah.
But those are the instances that really help me.
Yeah.
What I am learning at the and yeah, I realized what it was. You know, watching Dr. Orge manage this whole entire move, it got me thinking as to, I guess, the weight and the responsibility of a decision from a leader. And more than Dr. Orge's decision, but the people that have responded to the decision,
mm-hmm.
is something that I found very admirable.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because everyone's really taking it to stride.
Yeah.
And, you know, if this was anywhere else, like, I would expect a riot or, like, a student movement.
Yeah.
To really, like, to say, let's not move, or, like, you know, just petition and really fight for not moving.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the whole process was accepted gracefully, but by the entire school.
Mm-hmm.
And the professors, I think they're setting that example too, of just like all that humility. And I think everyone's doing it in the right manner, and I'm learning from that.
Mm.
That we are, I am in the process of moving with the school, because I'm moving down to Ontario next semester.
Mm-hmm.
And to just be part of like this movement and not be so disgruntled about it, if anything, mm-hmm. hopeful for the future. Well, I think this is a blessed time for all of us.
Mm-hmm.
I have a concern, I'm kind of thinking, predicting almost, that there might be a little bit of emotion at the end.
Yeah.
At the very end.
Yeah.
Just because it's that we physically take a step away.
Right.
I think there might be something then there, but nah. No, right now everyone's pretty content.
Yeah. Well, what is your most prized achievement you've earned while at this campus? You can take that question however you want.
Uh, I'm going to say new perspective.
Mm.
There's so much I can talk about. Let me try to pick and choose without going too far. But I have to mention, I understood church planting to be the product of a church split.
Mm.
And I'm talking about a very negative thing right now.
Sure.
I thought church plants happened because some part of the congregation wanted to smoke after church.
Mm.
And when they weren't allowed, and when the, you know, head pastor was like preaching against them, like on Sundays,
mm-hmm.
they got upset personally, like abused, and they left the church and they thought, hey, let's just make a church of our own. And they invite another pastor, and the pastor comes and they start up a church.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, well, okay, so you're starting a church because you want to have, you know, you want to have a ziggy after you know, service. I was like, nah, that can't be right. That was my understanding of church plant.
Yeah, okay.
I come to Golden Gate Seminary, and I had to throw out my understanding of church plant.
Mm-hmm.
That I've seen for 20 something years of my life,
mm-hmm.
and redefine it to be biblical and positive.
Yeah.
And that breakthrough, I think, is crucial for my future ministries.
Mm-hmm.
Because my understanding was, oh, I have to go back to Australia and find a nice big church,
mm-hmm.
and branch off from there or something like that.
Yeah.
And that's not a church plant.
Yeah.
That's just piggybacking, I don't know what that is, right?
Okay, yeah.
But what I'm planning now is, hey, I can actually take this back to Australia and really do it, and really pick up a model here. And again, I'm using the seminary moving as a perfect example. Is that, you know, there's church plants all over San Francisco, the Bay Area right now.
Mm-hmm.
We go down to Ontario, that place, people are like flooding in as well. It's the population is growing.
Yeah.
There's plenty of opportunities to, you know, look, see how church plants work there as well, and see how new startups happen. And
mm-hmm.
So yeah, I mean, like I said, the experience that I'm getting from just watching my friends do it as well is just life changing for me.
Mm.
Mm. So that's one of them, and I think another major one is. I have been part of a charismatic church all my life.
Mm.
And
it's a very different setting then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm Korean background as well, so you know, the Korean church I was at,
mm-hmm.
when we do prayer sessions and when we do, like, you know, youth retreats, I thought it was obvious to do at least 4 hours of prayer time at night. So it started at 11, finished at 3 in the morning. I thought everyone did that.
Mm-hmm.
I got here and I found something different.
Mm-hmm.
And I was freaked by it. Because I was thinking, how do you, you know, like, why are you guys so controlling of worship, you know? Like, but again, what I realized was, no, God is using this as much as the other.
Mm.
And what is God like? What are we learning from this model compared to the one that I had before?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I did, and because at first it was like, which one's better? But I realized that's a bad question.
Mm.
Which one works in which setting was a better question,
mm-hmm.
or more so, why did this work in that instance, and why wouldn't it work in this instance?
Right. There are Christians I've met who are looking for a church, and when I was younger, I thought, well, you should come to my church so that you can be in my church. But now I realize that different people have different fits, and some people who fit in a Baptist church, or at least a non-charismatic Baptist church, would not fit, you know, in a charismatic congregation, or vice versa.
Yeah.
There are people who are better fits for a charismatic congregation than not.
Yeah. And so as a leader, future church leader,
mm-hmm.
you know, where am I going to take this?
Yeah.
which setting am I going to... Because I will need to make a conscious decision of either doing this or that.
Yeah.
Or find a middle. But as you can tell, like, for me to be exposed to something very old school, I guess. I'm going to use the word old school because... Okay, no, that's a bad word. Old school's not... No, that's a bad word. It's just... And I don't want to use the word controlled because that's not what it is.
The way that I often hear it described, especially by Dr. Durst, is comparing order versus ardor.
Mm.
So it's a valuation of kind of orderliness, all things in order, being juxtaposed with the passionate ardor of the, if we're comparing these two, of the other one.
That's great. Yeah. That's great. So as you can tell, I've been thinking about that topic and as in, you know, how worship should look like. And I realized that a lot of my understanding has changed over the years.
Mm.
Over the last 2 years.
And I think it's really awesome that you're connecting with folks like us, folks like me. I'm not personally a complete cessationist, but I'm also not charismatic either. And I think it's awesome when we come together like this. And whichever way you go, I don't know. And maybe you don't even know yet.
Mm.
But when we have these connection points and have these times of training together, how we can now go out into ministry and do ecumenical ministry together. Like Presbyterians and Baptists, Charismatics and Cessationists can join together to feed the poor and work against the mindset that leads people to choose abortions and so on. So I think that is awesome.
Mm.
I love that about your story.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I had a very good opportunity. I don't know if that's a future question, but...
You're actually already answering like three other questions at the same time.
Yeah.
You're prescient. That's what it is.
So you can just add... You can add the questions later. That's right. Specifically, a... Because I'm predicting a question, something along the lines of, what was one of the most influential experiences you had here? I'm going to tie this in with the previous answer of like academic and all that stuff, and just I think everything in general. This event is called Horizon, and it's a unification of, you know, I'm going to say around 20 churches for the sake of numbers, whatever it is, around 20 churches, big and small. When I say big, I mean, you know, Bay Areas that don't get that big, and small gets, you know, I have five kids,
yeah.
So we're talking about a variety of just big and small. 20 churches get together and we go on a youth retreat together.
Mm.
And that was led by a, I guess, you know, like a collective group of pastors, you know, graduated and whatnot, but, you know, leaders in this area, and how they take the church and how we all got together and, you know, we meet every 2 weeks and we're preparing this retreat for these kids. And that's when I was a little bit, That was my biggest challenge, I guess, because I'm used to... I lead worship.
Mm.
Well, I used to lead worship anyway. I mean, when... You know. Anyway, I used to regularly lead worship. Now I do it now every now and then.
Mm-hmm.
But when I used to regularly lead worship, I considered myself to be... to a certain extent... I know the dangers of this word, but professionalism, like,
okay,
as in, I don't want to like say that I'm a professional, but I had the mindset of doing stuff, you know, practicing with excellence, you know, getting to that level of excellence, and I understand the dangers, and I just can't think of the perfect word, but all I know is that I always had the mindset of thinking, hey, we need to do as the best we can. Right, and the best we can kind of equated to at least 3 to 4 hours.
Mm.
And our worship conferences will go for like 3 hours at least. And the sermon in between, we'll specifically ask the pastor to do like a 10-minute standing. So out of the hour and a half
mm-hmm.
of worship, like praise,
yeah.
and then about 10 minutes of standing, like sermon,
yeah.
and then invitation to pray, and then prayer goes for another hour and a half, something mm-hmm. like that.
Yeah.
And so it was a very like open, free, kind of flowing kind of thing going on. And I got to Horizon,
mm-hmm.
and that's my background.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I've been doing my ministry, and now I'm a you know a youth pastor, so I need I'm just trying to learn as much as I can. And I got to Horizon, and they said, "Can you lead praise?" And I said, "Of course, like you know, I'd love to." And then they gave me 30 minutes, and mm-hmm. I was shell shocked. I literally couldn't speak for 2 minutes. On the phone, and my friend thought I was very angry, but I wasn't angry. I was actually just trying to comprehend what that meant.
Yeah, yeah. Like, how do you fit that much worship into 30 minutes like that?
And that was the biggest challenge that I've had,
mm-hmm.
because I've done it for such a long time in a certain way, and I got pretty good at what I was doing in that certain way.
Yeah.
That I realized that what can you do with 30 minutes? And so like. You know, you can understand like the confusion that I had because it was a split between, you know, you think you're good, but why can't you do it in 30 minutes? Of course you can do it in 30 minutes. At the same time, how can anyone worship God for 30 minutes? Why only 30 minutes? Why the yeah. limiting? Why are they limiting the spirit? You know, and I was like, yeah, yeah. And I'm like, okay, as you can tell, it's chaotic. But ever since coming to seminary, humility was the key word that God gave me.
Mm.
And I held on and I said, okay, but give me 40.
It's a good compromise.
And he was like, okay. So, but it was those instances where I had to draw the picture in my head.
Mm-hmm.
But then being forced to do it in a certain way before people were like, yeah, do whatever is good for you. In a bigger organization and where you have a very specific task
yeah.
to fit that, I thought that was a moment where I learned how to really understand unity.
Mm.
That if I did it for 3 hours, that's me,
mm-hmm.
but not the group.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was trying to picture, like, how was Horizon run?
Mm-hmm.
How did it operate till now?
Yeah.
How much do I respect what they were doing? And isn't that why I'm taking my kids there?
Right.
And, you know, just all that stuff. And so I had to understand and appreciate, like, something new. And that was a great experience for me. Because
mm-hmm.
that was very shockingly... Yeah, it was a very shocking thing for me. Because I learned how to exercise humility. Yeah. To just really say, yeah, sure, I'll do exactly what you want me to do.
Yeah.
And
I like that you brought up unity, because I think about unity a lot in my dissertation. I'm working in a corner of ecclesiology, and I think the more I think about it, the more I read the scriptures, the more I observe churches living their weekly lives, the more it is apparent to me that unity comes through hardship and struggle. It's not what's easy. Unity is not lowest common denominator. It's coming together, and that's hard sometimes. Whether we're coming over our what we're used to, or something even harder than that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's yeah. I think you know that's exactly right. As in, I was bringing in a product. I'm going to use the word product because that's what I am, right?
Okay.
I have a skill set.
Yeah.
They have a skill set. And they all collide into one place. And I think for unity, it's powerful because it has a color. It's a very colorful palette.
Mm-hmm.
I think my Sunday church is my color.
Yeah.
Right, and yeah. another church's Sunday is it's their own color, and But then once you get these events happening, especially in the Bay Area with, like, you know, small church, whatever it is, when we all got together, it was very colorful.
Mm-hmm.
That it wasn't, and we were trying to bring the best out of each other.
Yeah.
And because I knew how to do my part, all I had to do was match my part for the bigger picture.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I think that, so yeah, unity. I think I just named it. I learned something new about unity.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it just helped me name it. Yeah. So yeah. So yeah, that was my, I think, biggest experience.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not academic.
Sure. Yeah. All right. Now you've mentioned that you learned about Golden Gate after it was already announced that the sale had gone through. Is that correct?
Yeah. I'll
ask you our next question anyway. So before the announced sale of the Mill Valley campus on April 1st, 2014, what was your impression of the relationship between Golden Gate's Mill Valley campus and our neighbors? And, I mean, since you weren't aware of us before then, you weren't here before then, you could skip that if you'd want, or...
Before I answer that question, it's crazy because I applied, I think, in May or June,
mm-hmm.
like a couple of weeks from deadline.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because that was when God really called me,
mm-hmm.
and that's when I really just went all in.
Mm-hmm.
I really went all in. And in that process, that was when I was researching, and I guess that's why it just popped up to it. I didn't know it was that close to my decision to come into Golden Gate.
Oh, yeah. It was April 1st, 2014.
Yeah.
In fact, I personally was raised Southern Baptist. So the original church that I was at the Sunday after I was born is Southern Baptist. The church that I finished growing up in for my childhood years is Southern Baptist. And so I know a lot of people who are Southern Baptist, family members, friends, and so on. I got a lot of text messages that day. Is this an April Fool's joke?
My goodness.
I think it probably has to do with the way things move, with timing, with as regards the sale. And I think word was starting to get out to news outlets. And so the seminary wouldn't want staff and students to find out through some other source. It's us, you know. We are this group, and we wanted to be able to share it with each other, I think, is what the thinking was. It's just a guess. I don't know for sure. We haven't had our interview with Dr. Borge yet.
Yeah. So like I said, I was exposed to that news,
mm-hmm.
around the time I was considering.
Mm-hmm.
So which tells you how late I decided to join the seminary.
That's all right.
Yeah. But this was the only one I applied to.
Mm.
And because I really felt that God was calling me towards this area.
Mm.
And the opportunity was just, I just felt like, you know, I said, God, you know me.
Mm-hmm.
You know how much I need the ocean growing up in Sydney.
Yeah.
And you know how, how much I would like to, really have as much experience as I can.
Mm.
And yeah, San Francisco just popped in. With the idea of like the community, I'm sure that other interviewees would say completely different answers from mine. But when I got off at the airport and I went to pick up my stuff, I was at the taxi booth because I realized I had two massive carriers, my guitar and my backpack, mm-hmm. and I thought, nah, I'm not gonna bust this. Nah, I'll bite the bullet. I'll just taxi it. You know, San Francisco, how far could it be? So I got into the taxi and I said, do you know Golden Gate Baptist Theological Seminary? And he goes, what? No. I was like, I think it's in San Francisco. He's like, oh, okay. So and when I said San Francisco, he thought the city. But for me, when I say San Francisco, I just mean this area.
Yeah.
But then in America, you guys will just nail down, no, we're from Mill Valley, Right. We're Marion County. Get out of here.
Very granular sort of regionalism.
Yeah. It's like, I'm from Oakland. I'm like, it's all the same thing. It's all the same thing. Okay, I know. I'm not going to get that. Look, I'm sorry. I'm Australian in that aspect. Just saying I'm from Sydney. It doesn't mean... Okay, anyway. So when I said San Francisco, the guy looks at me and goes, I've never heard of it. And I gave him the address. He goes, now this is Mill Valley. And I said, is that far? he's like, it's across the bridge. I was like, you know, I have $100. Is that enough? He's like, yeah, that's fine. So I paid $100 to get here. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so we went down. Now I think about it, he took me down 19th Avenue.
Yeah.
Yeah. From this, this is the 73 or 280 something. But anyway. Yeah. And he took me to 19th and he's taking me down and I can see Golden Gate Bridge and we're about to cross. I'm like, wait, we're crossing the bridge? He's like, yeah. It's like, what? Where are we? Like, where am I going? And we drove in and we get off at, you know, the administration building and the taxi driver just parks into the president's spot. Across it, actually. You know, he passes.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
He
perpendicular
to it. So it was brilliant. Now that I know where it was, and I got all my stuff out, and I went up to Shane, and you know, I said hi to Shane, and he showed me to my room. But what I'm trying to get to is, as I was coming into Mill Valley, he's like, "Oh, you know, because I was paying him $100, I'm taxiing it in. It's Marin County." He's like,
right.
"This is, you know, if you ever need me," he gave me his card. Because, you know, like, he said, I'll drive you wherever you need.
Yeah.
I didn't realize what it meant. But I knew something was up. But then I realized this is a very, very rich neighborhood.
Yeah.
And he knew it. Everyone knew it but me. And so as far as I understand what the local community was like, I just knew that it was like Sydney. As in everything was overpriced. And very, just very cordial.
Mm.
Happy, sophisticated, cordial. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Very just well-to-do.
Yeah.
And yeah, I went to a very similar area. I didn't live in, but I went to a school in a very like similar neighborhood where people were very well-to-do.
Yeah.
Very expensive.
Mm.
And so I just thought, I thought America was cheap, but this is the same as Australia. So I wasn't too upset with how things were priced, because it was like,
yeah,
coffee's $2.50, coffee's $3. That's fine.
Yeah,
but not for a guy from Oklahoma.
Yeah. All right.
So that was I wasn't too aware of it.
Well, our next question's about changing impression of the community after the announcement of the sale, and then whether or not you were in on the discussions surrounding the potential sale before it was finalized. But no. That obviously wasn't true. You first learned about us after
the sale. Yeah.
So when you first learned about the sale of the campus, what was your initial opinion?
Okay. Not just me, but every single person I've been telling, no one's heard of a school moving.
Yeah.
And so when I first read, I thought, oh, the school's done? I thought, is the school done? And it wasn't that.
Right.
So I was like, what does it mean?
Mm-hmm.
And I was just trying to comprehend what it actually meant. And it just meant that we're moving.
Yeah.
And I thought, people move. I guess there's a reason behind it. I don't really care for now, because I get to live in two different cities.
Yeah, okay.
Once I got here, though, my concern is, as a local, I do ministry in San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
As a local pastor, I realized this area needs us. It really needs the continual flow and blessing of, you know, I'm not just going to say Southern Baptist, but just Christian leaders.
Yeah.
Like strong Christian leaders. And so when they decided to do Fremont campus, I wish that it would have been a little bit bigger, or maybe a little bit more, you know, like not a commuting thing, but rather a actual like seminary experience. Like, you know what I'm trying to say.
With like housing.
With the housing and just like a community. Just because this area is, because everything's so small.
Yeah.
We need networking and we need connections, like continuous connections. And if the school can provide some kind of like connecting, like, you know, settings where students, I mean, a dormitory is perfect because what do guys do when they, you know, when they eat and when they just, you know, do laundry, whatever it is, to, you know, when they're in their rooms,
yeah,
they go to each other and they talk about their ministries.
Yeah.
And that creates synergy to like really like bind and unite, you know, unify like different churches. And that's how Horizon started, was that it was started by three Golden Gate students who were in the dorms that were praying for each other and realized, hey, I'm going to camp. Do you want to come with me? Hey, let's all go together. Three churches went together. Just, you know, so to have that in Bay Area, I think it's just crucial.
Mm.
Networking is, I think, is the key point.
Mm.
I don't know what's going to look like down in Ontario.
Yeah.
But
I think very few people do.
But right, but here, I really wish that the school can have some form of structure that would instigate the students to really unify and just get together and talk about their ministries.
Yeah.
Because this area needs connections more than other churches, I think.
Yeah.
Because other churches, they can go independent. They can kind of grow internally and really like just, you know, do their own stuff because there's numbers. They have numbers.
Yeah.
The volume is different.
Yeah.
And if you have different volume, then you have more power, like manpower to do certain things. And I think the church can internalize that. But in the Bay Area churches, I think it's very hard for churches to generate their own, you know, manpower to to really do stuff together for the community and stuff like that. Mm. I'm and this isn't like a matter of me trying to like, you know, make it sound like, you know, smaller churches are like, you know, less influential. That's not my point. My point is there's certain events where we need to have like a little bit more manpower.
Yeah.
Like, because I mean, I'm going to use like retreats for one. If you have five people, you can't really go on a retreat.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And like even mission conferences, whatever conference it is, if those are little times where, you know, people can go together and really pray together, that's different when new topics, and really listen to like, you know, very proficient speakers. Because some small churches might, you know, they always listen to the same sermon. And I'm not, again, it's good to have that little extra input of
another Christian voice.
Yeah. Just and that creates noise and that creates, you know, energy and momentum and awareness. So
yeah.
And it's challenging when you look at other Christians do other stuff. So again, with my point of view for the school moving and all that is that that the Bay Area needs unification and the Bay Area needs connections, and I just hope that the Fremont campus can really do that. And, you know, I'm going up to Ontario, and we, when I say we, I mean the guys who are going, we need to really understand the community first.
Mm.
We need to understand what's going to happen there, who we're serving,
mm-hmm.
like who our neighbors are, and then come up with something that would match them.
Yeah.
Something that I learned.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you've answered the next question already, so I'm going to move to the last one.
Okay.
What do you hope the seminary will prioritize as they make this historic transition?
I think that the seminary, by making this decision to move us all away from our existing ministries, need to be lenient and understanding to accommodate the transitioning students.
Mm.
What I'm trying to say is some of my friends, F1 students and, you know, whatever other students, they are having trouble finding housing.
Mm-hmm.
And they were told that they could study in Fremont, but now they're forced to study in Mill Valley. And they say that's a blessing. But housing has not been but housing just been dumped onto the responsibility of the students. And I thought that was a big concern, because it's a fatal distraction.
Mm-hmm.
Where do I live?
Yeah.
And if I'm going to study in Fremont, then where should I be living as a student?
Right.
Right? Do I have to continue living around Mill Valley area? How? Do I have to live next to my church? Then Mill Valley campus is very far.
Yeah.
And, you know, it all comes down, but then it's not the school's responsibility, because, you know, they're going to call the Fremont campus a commuter campus. But I think that there is a responsibility, because they still have made that decision. And if this is going to make a significant impact to their existing ministries, I think that needs to be addressed. And so the point I'm trying to make is, bottom line, to answer your question exactly, is to say, I think that the school, in its moving process, should realize that we are all pastors, that we are all ministers,
mm-hmm.
and that the school should help us focus on our ministries and not be a distraction as much as they can.
Mm-hmm.
And guys like me who are going down to Ontario, it's easy, because
right.
I can just, you know, go into the student housing they prepared down there. You know, I had the discomfort as an F1 student to go study in Braille and, you know, live in Ontario for a semester or so.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I've already made that commitment. I mean, that's, again, it's more experience. I don't mind doing that.
Yeah.
But for students who are going to be in the Bay Area, to be... Because they think about what they're losing. They're losing this.
Yeah.
They're losing this.
Yeah.
And they're holding the fort for the Bay Area.
Mm-hmm.
And if we know that Bay Area is like one of the most weakest, like, you know, the most least Christian area in America, the school is taking away a massive, massive, like, weapon from them.
Mm-hmm.
And they're almost like just leaving them here.
Yeah.
You know, again, the Fremont campus, it's going to be the Mill Valley campus for a semester, but then, you know, there's that distraction of, what about housing?
Mm-hmm.
You know, like,
yeah.
Are we now subject to the, you know, secular company, and if they jack up the prices, what happens then?
Yeah.
You know? And the school can just say, hey, but you guys already were going to commit to just staying here.
Mm-hmm.
But again, I think that's not touching at the heart of the students. You know what I'm trying to say, right?
Yeah.
They're not really touching at the heart of the students when they say, you made a commitment to this. It's your responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
But then, you know, it's for the students' point of view, it's like, no, you guys decide to leave.
Yeah.
Again, so I think there's that... I think that the school needs to focus on helping out the existing ministries in the Bay Area.
Yeah, especially by way of housing assistance in the near term.
In the near term, and mm-hmm. also just not just from housing as well, but just to, like, again, keep bring that back, is, you know, create ways for the students to continue speaking to each other and really, like, communicating to each other.
Yeah.
Because it feels like everyone's going to focus all their energies onto Ontario,
mm-hmm.
but then that's going to take away a massive weapon. And then, you know, just resource, there's just a vast amount of resources are going to be lost from the Bay Area. And I think the school needs to be a little bit more conscious of what they're leaving behind.
Yeah.
Because it's not a new beginning. It's a continued fight.
Mm-hmm.
And we're leaving a very specific war zone.
Mm-hmm.
And when we pull the main headquarters out of the, you know, war zone,
mm-hmm.
and we've got, you know, we've got the guys who are going to be, you know, left behind. They're still, if anything, they should be taken care of more than the people who are going to go down, is my opinion.
Mm.
Because we have the momentum, the drive, the resources, the energy of, like, the school moving in that direction.
Yeah.
But because of the momentum, the stragglers, I believe that, I think they're just getting a little bit, you're on your own now.
Mm.
Am I trying to be too, like, am I, you know, trying to make them sound too, like, I'm not saying, you know, we should, like, babysit them or anything like that. It's,
yeah, yeah.
But but the school really needs to just remember and kind of support them as much as, like, support the troops left behind as much as they can.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think you make a good point. Yeah. And I hope that they will, too. I know they've offered some housing assistance, and I know that Dr. Durst and the rest are trying to work out this new campus, you know, to make it the best it can be. So for those of us who stay, gotta work to meet those things that you're talking about. I think those are completely valid concerns. Yeah. Well, Daniel, I'd like to thank you for your time. I really appreciate it.
That was Daniel Choi, current Master of Divinity student here at Golden Gate Baptist Theological Seminary.
All right, well, Jonathan, that was your first time listening to the interview with Daniel, and I wanted to ask you, what did you especially like or appreciate about that talk that he and I had?
His discussion of cross-cultural expectations of worship was really fascinating and enjoyable.
Mm-hmm.
As a librarian, it's always encouraging to me to know that my job actually fits with the rest of the vision of the seminary.
Yeah.
And so when he didn't use this term, but when he described information literacy and the assistance that I gave him with that, and that Dr. Orge talked about the same types of things in the preaching class on effective use of materials in preaching, it's good to hear that my job fits with the larger teaching ministry of the institution.
Right, yeah, for sure. For my part, I liked that he came here because of the move. That it was more than just, ooh, an ocean, I'll go there. He cared about the convictions that the seminary adheres to, and he cared about getting a fuller, richer experience with culture and ministry in two different metropolitan areas in another country before he presumably goes back home to Australia to do ministry.
It's a unique opportunity, a really special thing that he gets to experience.
Yeah.
What would it take for you to go overseas to do education, even going at a place that still speaks English?
Well, for me, it comes down to essentially two reasons. I would go either to study with a particular expert in his or her field, with that field being something I'm personally interested in, whether that's the epistles of Paul to the Corinthians or the Gospel of Matthew, Gospel of John, something like that. And the other reason would be if that school's vision for how to do ministry, how they wanted to educate somebody to get into ministerial thought and practice, that would be theoretically something that could draw me overseas, I think. So maybe I'm not as brave as Daniel is. But that's what it would take for me. But what about you? What would it take for you to go overseas to study?
I think, again, a compelling ministerial or educational vision, or a particular expert in my field of study, would be the type of thing that would draw me to make a large move. It was the type of thing that brought me and my wife up to Golden Gate.
Yeah.
So my doctoral advisor had been somewhere else, perhaps I would have made a decision like Daniel. But
yeah. Well,
speaking of compelling visions of and experts in our related subjects, tell us about next week's episode.
Well, our next episode is with Dr. Rick Melick. He is the Distinguished Professor of New Testament, which is an actual title, for those of you who don't know, not just an adjective. And he's also affiliated faculty with Golden Gate's Graduate Studies Program. For those of you who are listening, hope you will subscribe, whether that's on YouTube, iTunes, or another podcast app or platform. We ask that you please give us a rating on there, whether that's a like on YouTube or some sort of starred rating on iTunes, preferably something above zero. And if you would write some sort of review, every single one of those things helps us to cast a wider net with our audience to reach more people with this conversational history at the moment about the campus relocation of Golden Gate, and in the future about other historical subjects and areas. So every time you share, rate, subscribe, like, and review, you're helping us out. We really appreciate it.
Episodes will release every 2 weeks with a new interview right here on iTunes, YouTube, or your favorite podcasting platform, whichever one you choose to listen to us on. For details on our methodology for the campus relocation project, please listen to our episode 0, available now. Episode 3, again, with Dr. Rick Melick, will be available April 29th.
And that's all we've got for this episode. May God bless you as you go. He's already gone before.